My topic for today's approach to prescribing strong opioids for managing pain. It's a little broad topic, and I have tried to concentrate the scope of this discussion. Beginning with the beginning, that is, suppose a tiger attacks us, and we know that we have the flight and fight response, and obviously with the tiger, we would rather go by the flight response. There are systems within the body, while we are doing this flight response, there is an inbuilt system, just like there is a nociceptive system for perceiving the pain, even if the tiger has bitten you and you are in severe pain, with the analgesia created by the internal opioids with us, endorphins, we are able to dull the pain, veil that sense of doom with a sense of well-being enough to move away and protect ourselves. So we need to acknowledge the presence of this inbuilt system to manage pain and stress, which we are utilizing in our quest to reduce the pain and stress through external opioids. So today's topic being external opioids, I will be approaching the topic from a patient in pain along these lines. That is, first is evaluating the pain and evaluating the patient, beginning to prescribe opioid therapy after this is done, and reviewing the patient who is on opioid therapy. And some of the topics will not be covered. So I had done a brief survey with the students, and 16 of them responded. So there were many topics of interest, and I saw that many of them are already scheduled for discussion in later sessions. So I'll be concentrating on some of the salient aspects of prescribing morphine for pain. So we are indebted to the WHO analgesic ladder, and the story began in October 1982. Sir alluded to it last class. So in this beautiful poetic villa in Milan, Italy, six international experts came together. Many of them were internet pain specialists, and one palliative care physician, that is Dr. Robert Wycross from St. Christopher. And the main debate was, it is very beautiful to understand, because I thought it was relevant to understand why we are giving pain relief to our patients. So debate was between whether the pain severity, the pain score has to be brought down, which was the point of view of the Sloan's group from the USA, versus the patient is relieved of pain so that he can move on to doing something. This was the point brought about by the great teacher whom we all fondly remember. I had a good opportunity to be his student during my early days. And he had this sharp pen, put things clearly into the concept clearly, the ability to make things simple. He thought of the idea of progressive stages of analgesic ladder, and he had the right goals for the analgesic therapy, that is, giving new hope and incentive to live by giving good pain relief. So we know currently the WHO ladder, but to know the story behind it is really inspiring and motivating, and I felt it was important to mention that, that we could have just had intermittent subcutaneous parenteral dosing as our method of treatment. But we are very indebted to Dr. Wycross for making things so simple that person can sit at home and have the medicine looking at the clock and using the medicines. And they are reasonably effective. And from the literature, between 76 to 90% of the patients can be controlled with using this appropriately. So we all have gold, opioids as the gold standard. And it has also, besides the analgesic ladder, it has also entered into every WHO model list of essential medicine. It is there in many of our state essential medicines list, as well as our national essential medicine list. And it has entered into the recommendations of several international bodies. Now, with all this available, the scenario in India is still a lot to be looked into, because a study which was published in 2017 from 1,600 patients with cancer in four regional centers showed that nearly 70% of the patients were inadequately treated with analgesics. And more interestingly, the pain, when it was mild, it was more easily handled. But as the pain became moderate to severe, you can see that nearly 80% or 94% had inadequate analgesic therapy. This surely reveals that there is something of inadequacy when the pain gets severe, and this kind of lectures probably would help support prevent this. And all these were departments which had palliative care units working, all these were institutions with palliative care units existent within the institution. Now, this is a map which is made in scale with the percentage of utilization of opioids to meet the need of for pain relief. This has been released by the International Narcotics Control Board, and we can see that India is just 4% here, and that means more than 96% patients in India have no access to opioid analgesics, and when it comes to children, it's probably even lesser. So this is the state of the pain access to pain relief in India, and very often we talk about the opioid crisis in the US, but if you look into that map, you will see that 90% of the opioids are used by 10% of population. And you can see the per capita consumption of opioids, where it is. I had to break the graph to create this. And the per capita consumption in India, where it is 0.54 milligrams per capita. So there is a huge difference. And we just cannot compare the opioid crisis, which happened due to indiscriminate overprescription in the US for touching a benchmark. And it was open to all pains, including non-cancer pains. And it was done by primary care physicians with the lack of access to treating excruciating severe pain of chronic diseases like cancer in India. We just cannot compare. And these concepts are important while we are prescribing opioids. So this is Sri Chauhan, who came to our OPD after he was treated at a specialist oncology center and shifted when the paresis became paraplegia due to a metastatic cancer prostate to the spine. Now, patient was on multiple, besides gabapentin, he was on multiple other drugs. And patient had severe back pain, 9/10, unremitting. It was not radiating. And the patient was unable to sit, lie, or move. Completely in distress, sad, withdrawn, and without hope. He had a very supportive family who could only share his suffering. He was insured. There was no dearth of funds. Now, this is a situation in India, and I gave you the background as to why patients are in great suffering. And this suffering has been found across as contributing to most of the serious health-related suffering by the Lancet Commission, which released its report in 2017-18. Now, Dr. Twycross aimed to remove or reduce this suffering and provide new hope and incentive to live. Now, let us evaluate the pain. Coming to core topic, so the opioids are required for when the pain is nociceptive, predominant pain. It could be acute, it could be chronic. So you can see the fracture, burns, or post-operative infarction, malignant, non-malignant pain. The benchmark is the severity, and opioid therapy is decided based on sensitivity of the pain and severity of the pain, and not based on diagnosis, prognosis, or lifespan that is left. So it may be indicated in many other diseases, but our judgment has to be proper. And we are not going to cover non-cancer pain in this particular talk because it's a huge topic by itself. It is important to document the pains, different pains separately, because some of them may be opioid sensitive, some of them may be completely unrelated. So it is good to document them and monitor them. And of course, we must acknowledge the distress, address and validate that aspect also right from the beginning. And now, other thing when we are evaluating pain is to look into what therapy has helped the patient. So if some of you can give me a quick response in chat, whether a patient, it's just a theoretical question, with this kind of medications, would that patient be ready to move on to step 3 as per the WHO ladder? So here a patient is receiving some of the drugs which are seen in step 1 and 2. And we have been taught that we have to move to step 3 if the pain remains uncontrolled. Anyone to chat? I know we should not be waiting a long time because we need to have FAQs. I don't see a chat. So we can see here that inadequate, the dose of step 2 is not optimal here. And also that it is possible because there's a cyclopam being used, we need to assess the pain correctly, whether it is nociceptive predominant or whether there is some amount of colic for which opioids may not be the right choices. Also, there are other issues with this prescription that there is a prokinetic along with an antispasmodic. There is multiple paracetamol in different combinations. That also we need to look into this exercise for the prescription. The second prescription I'm showing here is an example of a prescription where adequate optimal doses of step 2 has been tried and we may be able to move on to a step three. So this is important to understand. Before we decide the patient is uncontrolled, there are some drugs going on and we move on to step three, we need to look back, look at the drug history, the adherence to the drug drug prescriptions, and then decide whether we need to move on to step three. So this is an important step in prescribing strong opioids. Then we evaluate the patient. So now that we know the opioid pain is opioid sensitive, and it has been tried, step two adequate optimal doses have been tried. So now we are considering opioid therapy, but before actually prescribing, we still need to evaluate the patient. So here when we evaluate the patient, we look at risk of complications with opioids, what is the role of other therapies, multimodal inputs, and also is there a possibility for reviewing. But the risk of complication is based on systemic dysfunctions, renal, respiratory, hepatic, hydration of the patient, etc. Some of the symptoms can influence our decision, shortness of breath, GI symptoms, like especially constipation, nausea, vomiting that is already existing will affect our prescription because we may change the choice of drug or the dose, or we may add new drugs. Even the nutritional levels and sleep apnea, because you know these patients have a higher risk and higher sensitivity to the side effects of opioids. The ongoing other drugs other than the analgesics also can increase the sensitivity of the patient to pain. Now, the role of other therapies need to be considered at this stage. Does this patient, will this patient do better with an additional radiotherapy? Will an abscess drainage help? Is there a fracture that can be mend? And you know, is there a role for physiotherapy, occupational therapy, etc., or interventional? Is there a need for counseling because there are negative thoughts? So all these need to be considered. And then we move on to a decision about using opioid therapy. A very important aspect, now that we know that the patient is all right and we can use, and the pain is the right pain to be chosen for opioid therapy, we still need to ask a few more questions to ourselves before actually prescribing. That is, how can I follow up this patient? It is irresponsible on our side to prescribe opioids when there is no way of following up the patient. It may be better to prescribe something which patient can handle even in the region that wherever he is staying. From where will the patient get the medicine? That is also an important consideration. Now, we may stock the medicine ourselves by following the stocking and dispensing mandatory requirements of the NDPS regulations. That is double lock cupboard, maintaining records of the dispensed drugs, patient details. There are specific forms to be used for maintaining. So when we are prescribing, we need to use all these we need to follow these requirements as per the regulations of the country. The website which I have indicated here gives more details, and maybe in the future there may be a session with details of how to be a doctor in charge of an RMI. So these prescriptions, etc., are stored for 2 years. So this is also important knowledge to be had that, you know, we need to have as a doctor in charge. Now, second point that I brought up is, how will I make sure that the patient gets the next refill? Patient may be within your region, can collect it through home care service, OPD, or other centers. But if the patient is staying far away, IAPC has a wonderful website with the directory, the palliative candidate centers directory, and we could see if there is something nearby for the patient to look into. And even Pallium India has a palliative care directory. And there is also, we should remember that NDPS regulations have certain provisions for sending the medicine by courier, by post, with certain mandatory requirements fulfilled. So all these are facilities for maintaining uninterrupted supply for the patient, which is an ethical obligation when we are starting the opioid. We cannot give the patient 2 weeks of pain relief and, you know, then again patient goes back into huge suffering. Now, we actually begin to prescribe opioids after these prerequisites are met. So here we look into discussing the meaning of the pain, because just by giving analgesics, we are not treating any pain. Pain is a negative, subjective, emotional, sensory experience. So we need to look into all aspects, agree on pain goals, look at the risks for non-medical opioid use, and then start using the drug with required communication. So since pain is a biopsycho-spiritual phenomenon, we have to look into the meaning and context of the pain, because that is what impacts the appraisal of the patient. The patient looks at the pain, is it dangerous to me? Is this controllable? So all these are happening in the prefrontal lobes of the brain through the pain pathway, which not only goes into somatosensory cortex, as the earlier figure showed, it goes into multiple other areas, which is limbic system and the arousal alert areas, etc. So the meaning and context of the pain has to be dwelt into through discussions, engaging with the patient, etc. We need to acknowledge the pain and address the distress. I will repeat this again because that is the most important aspect that we need to understand. And it's not just, we are not prescription monsters. We are human beings connecting with other human beings and with some kind of idea. And we need to understand they are the experts of the disease experience, and we are only knowing more about the disease and the drugs. We are not the complete experts. Together, we become experts in handling the situation. So along with analgesia, we have to give certain informations and communications and ensure that they feel that, you know, they get they are supported. They have trust and hope in us. And that itself raises the pain threshold and lowers the total dose of the drug that is required to be used in any particular situation. So next is the pain goal. Pain goals are what the patient considers as satisfactory endpoints to analgesic therapy. It is very rare for the patient to say that I want the pain score to come down to 3 as the pain goal. Generally, their pain goals are related to what they want to do after they achieve analgesia. So they might want to spend time with grandchildren. They might want to do some cooking for the family, go back to work or play a game of chess or simply rest. So this is important to understand because then we are working together. And also there is sometimes they are unrealistic, sometimes they are realistic, and we need to engage further regarding pain goals. Next point is risk of non-medical opioid use that the patient may engage in. So important to remind everyone that a patient will not be denied of strong opioids even if the risk is present. It's just that the monitoring gets enhanced. And I also know that Dr. Joyita is going to address this aspect later in one of the sessions. So what are the individual risk factors for non-medical opioid use? So a teenager male has a higher risk. An elderly woman has a lower risk. And there are other aspects, that is individual or family history of smoking or drinking, history of psychological morbidity, history of actually substance abuse, and socioeconomic status. All of them contribute for possibility of aberrant behavior. Aberrant behavior or non-medical opioid use does not mean substance abuse. Okay, there are also tools that we can use at the stage. We are talking about initiating, beginning prescription. So this is initiations. So in that itself, we have tools. The general non-specific tools are, of course, the CAGE tool, which was originally used for alcohol. Now it is also used for drugs. They are non-specific. And even there is a non-cancer pain tool, that is opioid risk tool, that is available. But recently, it has, very recently, Dr. Wittstum has brought out a very good article on opioid risk assessment specifically for cancer patients. And this is an online free open tool. And I have shown you the website where you can get it. Most important to remember here again is that a higher sensitivity to all this would be through a semi-structured clinical interview, preferably led by a psychologist or a counselor, but it can be led by any of the team member whom you have given the adequate training. Now, we are beginning to prescribe. The aim is to achieve the lowest effective dose, and we have ensured that the patient has got opioid sensitive pain. The opioid step 2 therapy has been tried. The other modalities of therapies have been tried, and now we can start. So we need to stop the step 2 before moving on to the step 3 medications. And then the choice depends on the patient's condition, the safety of use in that particular patient, the flexibility of this particular drug. So per oral immediate release tablet morphine is the commonest initiating drug. And so the morphine can be used at 5 or 10 milligrams based on the severity, previous opioid use, etc. And this is initiating dose. And it can also be sometimes we may not be able to start an oral tablet due to the symptoms of the patient. For example, severe nausea, vomiting, or there is a GI edema that is expected. So we may have to use parenteral dosing. And this is generally done by either morphine or fentanyl. It can be done in two ways. Sometimes it is used for just estimating the first oral dose. That is called an parenteral morphine trial or a fentanyl trial. And this is generally within 1 hour. we can achieve pain relief, and we can calculate the first dose of morphine that can be used based on what how much is required in the parenteral dosing. In the infusion way, we have to continue the infusion, and with 24 hours of titration, we understand the daily requirement and then convert it back into oral format and use it later. The other drugs which can be initiated are methadone, also in some patients where it is specifically indicated. For example, patients with neuropathic pain or kidney dysfunction. Here in an opioid naive patient, it is recommended to start at a very low dose at 2.5 milligrams, 12 hourly. And in an elderly, frail male or any other comorbidity, we could even reduce it to 1 milligram. The other drugs of sustained release or extended release tablets are more valuable as second line and not as useful as first line therapy. And so this is more useful in a very busy executive who has some issue with, you know, swallowing and or who prefers to have or who has a compliance issue. And these are the patients we could consider starting sustained release tablets. Now, there are requirements of prescription itself. So in the NDPS law, I have shown here in 52G, there are certain requirements which have to be followed. That is, the name, address of the doctor, as well as the patient needs to be shown very clearly. And the daily dose, the total quantity and the duration of the analgesic therapy has to be clearly indicated. Now, looking at into the prescription itself, we generally give an elaborate prescription as to when it should be taken. This 10 a.m. etc. can also be replaced by a clock phase so that even illiterate patient can also understand. And so we give step one medications if required, as medications which are taking care of the adverse effects as and when required. So always there is a stimulant laxative. And the tablet morphine itself, when we are starting, we need to look at the, I've just shown through two examples. So in a young patient, we may give as usual 4 hourly with a double dose at bedtime, etc. But in an older patient, we may start much lower and go much slower. So the bedtime need not be the double dose. We can keep it as an SOS dose and explain and then go much more gradually. So these are the slight nuances of initiating therapy based on the different patient conditions. So moving on, extra care is also required if the patient is dehydrated, patient has other disabilities or dysfunctions. And I was hoping that this could be a question, but I think it is difficult to handle that together. So in a patient with a hepatic dysfunction, there are, you know, other issues that we need to consider. That is, for example, a nausea, GI edema can affect absorption. And there may be an increased sensitivity because of metabolic dysfunction. There may be induction of enzymes, or there may be inactivity of enzyme because of the aggressive liver disease. There could be portal systemic shunting, which reduces the first pass. So again, there is active drug higher in the blood level, less plasma proteins, the encephalopathy can increase sensitivity. So this is just giving an example of one system dysfunction, and there is much more to be learned when we look into each system dysfunction. So all these are about initiating. Then I mentioned about information and education. These are one of the most important aspects of initiating. You may give the best prescription, but the patient will do exactly as he wishes, or the family may stop the patient from taking it if we have not elicited the questions and doubts that they have had and respond to them. So I have again given you a link here which has three videos which are looking into what goes into the conversation when we are initiating strong opioids for the first time in any patient family situation. It is not covering the whole topic comprehensively, but there are some concepts that are touched upon. We also need to explain to them, after they get the medicine, we always ask them to come back to the consulting room and show them which drug is to be used for what, preferably given small brown envelopes, and you know, explain correctly about adhering to it, safe storage, side effects, the common side effects as well as the serious side effects, and what to do about the common side effects, because we have already prescribed for them the serious side effects. They have to stop medicine and contact the clinic back. Importance of using the laxative. And also there are instructions to avoid using heavy machinery and driving until the dose is stabilized. This is done by initiating, and every time we titrate the medicines also. Even important decisions, etc., need to be prevented in the period of initiation, which generally lasts for about a week to 10 days. This is re-emphasized by having them printed on the back of the prescription booklet. So after all this is done, we need to also ensure that the multimodal therapy, like reference to a pain interventional pain specialist or a physiotherapist, is initiated, and the patient is understood whatever we have discussed by having them tell us back about all these aspects. Pain and drug diary is a useful tool, not mandatory, to ensure that we make the patient follow our instructions and we are able to titrate the medicine.
Madam, you are muted. Nandini, madam.
Nandini, you are muted.
So when did I get muted? This slide or the previous slide?
This slide.
Okay. So pain diary becomes an important, useful tool for us to ensure that the patient is adhering to the prescription, how many doses. So it helps us in titrating the drug. It also gives us an idea of the activity and the mood of the patient and any other side effects. So, So this is a very good tool for improving quality of care, but it's not mandatory. And these times, when it is COVID times, when we are dealing with patients virtually, this would be extremely useful for us to titrate from remote. And again, these are discussed in detail in Anuja's paper, which is recently published in the IJPC. Now we move on to, we have started the opioid therapy, send the patient home, and we have to review the patient and titrate the medicines. So there are 5 A's of review. Why do we need to titrate, first thing? Why can't we just use milligram per kg? Because the clinical potency and efficacy are unpredictable in patients. So it is not easy for us to calculate a particular patient's dose just by looking or weighing the patient. And also to achieve that lowest effective dose and minimize the adverse effects, we have to titrate the medicines. How do we do it? By reviewing. So Dr. Robert Whitecross comes back to my mind again, how he used to emphasize his 6'3" height, and he would stamp his foot and emphasize review. Now, the 5 A's is a structured way of reviewing a patient on opioid therapy. In brief, it is that analgesia, how much has it impacted? What impact has it had on the activities? Analgesia that we are creating, has it helped in improving any activity? Adverse effects, is there any aberrant behavior, and how has it affected the patient's mood? So let us look at each little briefly. So the first A is analgesia as an outcome. So before checking the score and deciding whether it is useful to titrate or not, important thing is to check whether the patient has adhered to the prescription. Dr. Rajgopal brought this point up very clearly, even in the last meeting where we discussed difficult pains. First thing is to ensure, has the patient followed the prescription and not being combative or aggressive about it? So let the patient be truthful to you by having, in a gentle manner, empathetic manner, understanding, and so that we understand their barriers and respond to it. This is another reason why I emphasized on eliciting their questions about opiophobia, etc. Otherwise, they will not have adhered to the treatment. So if the patient has adhered to the treatment, we gently upgrade the dose by 25 to 50% each time, and we bring the patient from severe to mild pain, and then to moderate pain, moderate pain and then to mild pain level. We do not aim to eliminate all pain because that will worsen the adverse effects. Our aim is to keep the pain in the mild pain range, and this is discussed when we are discussing the pain goal itself. So this is an important take home message. And the first step in activity, the second A is activity. So first step is to break this vicious cycle of, you know, the increasing pain causing the distress, affecting sleep, and then it worsens the pain because of the lower threshold. So our first aim is to give the patient a good night's sleep. And then we move on from that to continuing the pain relief when patient is awake and resting, and then moving on to allowing activities of daily living, then allowing psychosocial functioning. Patient is able to sit up and engage with people, talk, converse, and even make decisions. And then trying to reach the patient's pain goal, as we had discussed earlier. So all these are done sequentially, not in one shot, because that is when we achieve the lowest effective dose. Now, the adverse effects have to be balanced along with analgesia. While we are looking at activities and analgesia, we need to also check about the adverse effects. So the common ones as well as the serious ones. So serious ones are only when there is an overdose. or when there is a drug interaction. And the when we start with higher dose and we are titrating too fast, the risk of all these complications are higher. And so these risk benefits have to be also discussed with each dose escalation. Sometimes the patient may bargain a lesser pain relief. He may accept a lesser pain relief and he will say, I cannot handle this severe constipation. I don't mind having a little pain, but I do not want this severe constipation. So that may be a bargain that we can have by discussing with the patient. So the dictum of starting low, going slow, maintaining the dose so that the analgesia is at mild pain level and keeping it to just the required pain goal and not trying to achieve zero pain relief. These are all important aspects to reduce the adverse effects. Prophylactic medications can be used when adverse effects come. We know we have already talked about stimulant laxatives are most important, as you know, 99% of the patients do get it. And some of the others like nausea, drowsiness are only time bound and it may disappear. So we may give it as SOS in case the patient has it. Generally, a patient who has undergone a step 2 opioid therapy and has not had nausea, vomiting will not be suddenly having vomiting during the step 3 medications. So it is only 30% who may have this. And adding non-opioid and using multimodal therapy interventions or other therapies, physiotherapy, etc., can further reduce the dose. And changing the dose regime and route, as Dr. Rajgopal eloquently explained in the last session, can also change the adverse effect profile of the patient and still give useful analgesia. Again, following up the pain diary, if they have maintained it, will be of immense value, because all these are the same points which are discussed in the 5 A's, the analgesia, the activity, the adverse effects, the mood, etc. So these are important tools to improve the quality of care. I request for muting the telephones, the microphones. Now, how long is it that we can step up the dose, even when we review it? On the first day when we see a patient on opioid, do we up titrate? Usually not. We at least wait for 2 days, because all this depends on the steady state blood levels of the drug. And generally, steady state requires 5 times the half-life of the drug. So for immediate release tablet morphine, 3 to 5 hours is the half-life. So generally, we step up the dose only on the second day when we are using oral therapy. For intravenous, of course, as it is ongoing, we can increase because the half-life is in minutes. In sustained release, important to remember that we can only step up in 4 to 5 days because of their long half-life. In methadone, it is so variable that it has to be played individually with each patient and requires a good mentorship to understand the use of methadone. There is a good supplement in the IJPC specifically discussing the methadone, and please, I request all of you to go through it in detail. Now, just to give you an example of how does this play out, a patient who has started on 5 milligram has moved on to 7.5 milligram. Suppose he's taking this 4th hourly by the time it is, 6th or 7th day, and 2 rescue doses have caused stable pain relief. So now that we are calculating the total daily requirement, so 7.5 milligrams 6 times and 2 rescue doses of the same amount will give a total dose of 60 milligrams per day. And now this is given as 10 milligrams 4th hourly by dividing by 6. So this is how we calculate the dose requirement based on our previous day's requirements and by calculating the average daily dose and then dividing it by 6. 4A is aberrant behavior. Currently, it is no longer called as aberrant behavior. It is called as non-medical opioid use. This can come in the form of frequent opioid. Patient will keep, unscheduled appointments for opioid refills, or they may have, hoarding tendency. They may be seen as anxious or insomnic. They may have impaired functioning. They may say about stolen and lost prescription. They do doctor shopping, or they may inject oral formulations. So all of these are coming under the same umbrella of aberrant behavior, but some behaviors may be different in the sense unscheduled appointments for a frequent opioid refill may just indicate that the patient has had increased pain and the current prescription is not taking care of the pain. It may not be a really an aberrant behavior in terms of substance abuse, but a patient injecting oral formulations may be actually moving on. It's more dangerous. He may have to, it's more worrisome. Again, this topic, I see in the schedule, it is due for discussion, especially the one for substance abuse. Here we are discussing about how do we help the patient those who have had these issues or who are expressing these issues. We need to engage with them to understand why they are doing. The hoarding could be simply because the patient is, you know, worrying that how will I get this medicine in case my pain goes up. So these discussions can help us to understand whether there is sensitive, the patient is actually at a higher risk of substance abuse. And there are genetic predispositions based on the intensity, sensitivity of the mu receptors and the density of mu receptors in those limbic system areas where this is working. So also when a patient has not medical opioid use does not mean that we do not start opioids, it just means that enhanced monitoring. So the non-medical use is not just the property of the drug, it is also related to individual factors, especially genetic predispositions and certain developmental backgrounds. There is a ongoing opioid risk monitoring is this COM tool, current opioid misuse measure, and I've given a link here. Basically, we try to assess and stratify the risk, decide whether or not to prescribe when it comes to especially non-cancer pain. But in cancer pain, we just handle it, minimize the risk and monitor with enhanced monitor and respond to the aberrant behavior. In generally cancer patients, we do not stop using opioid because of some kind of non-medical opioid use. But just to give a fresh perspective, I think it comes later. So there are universal precautions for safe and rational use for everybody, irrespective of their risk. That is whatever we discussed till now, assessing for the right pain, nociceptive predominant pain, assessing the patient's comorbidities and ensuring that it is, you know, strategically prescribed, discussing the medication risks, benefits and side effects. All these are important precautions because we are using it appropriately, the right dose to the right patient. Setting expectations and managing the pain, integrating with other therapies, using non-opioids whenever that is relevant, monitoring the 5 A's, ensuring prescription adherence by checking pill counts and maintaining the record, engaging with the patient at every dose adjustments, integrating the multidisciplinary team in conversing the patient and using the specialist interventions when necessary, and maintaining correct documentation. So enhanced monitoring abroad may indicate a urine drug test, or there are agreements that the patient sign into, or there are state level prescription drug monitoring programs. We don't have any of that. We rely mostly on pill count, single prescription and our documentation. Now there has been a study which was, you know, done in Trivandrum. I'm not sure that it was Trivandrum or Calicut, but it was, the first author is Dr. Rajgopal, and it was done in 2001. So it is probably from Calicut. And they studied 1,723 patients under home care service and looked for medical use, misuse and diversion. And they found that there was no instance of misuse diversion. And the reason that they gave was that the accountability was maintained in the morphine stock as well as the prescriptions, diligent documentation of the dispensed drug and regular review incorporating pill counts is what prevented the misuse diversion. So this is reassuring for us to understand that whatever we follow is adequate. Urine drug toxicology may not be possible as a routine due to the, I think it costs nearly 4,000 rupees per test. It may not be practical. Fifth A, we are talking now about analgesia, activities, aberrant, adverse effects, aberrant behavior, and now the fifth A is affect. Have there been any changes to the emotional well-being? How is the patient's mood? Is the patient depressed, anxious, and would counseling help? So all these need to be looked into. And psychosocial aspects is another session which is coming in the future of IAPC Academy sessions. Effective communication can heal maladaptive cognition, meaning-making, and it can raise the threshold. As I told, the drug, the actual quantity of drug prescribed can come down if these aspects are looked into, because the pain pathway does not just go into somatosensory cortex. Now, we also need to look into ourselves reflectively. Sometimes we start off being very interested in the patient, and eventually when the patient's pain is not responding the way we would have hoped to, we start converting that deep concern becomes complacency, and after some time we feel like avoiding and hostility. Now, these are aspects we need to look into ourselves. And I think last lecture by Dr. Rajgopal can help us a lot in when we are reaching this stage where the patient is not showing the required response that we would have liked. This is a summary of our 5 A's. And so this is how I have discussed this particular topic. I still would like to again thank Dr. Twycross. And this was his slogan, IMA, he would say, evaluate the pain and the patient, explain the, communicate the goals, benefits, side effects, listen to the patient, respond to all the queries, manage by establishing ground rules for prescription, and by using the right drug to the right patient, monitor, ensure follow-up, attention to details, and all these are going to take us a long way and reach the lowest effective dose. And this is not just by the prescription. We have to respond to the distress. The meaning is addressed. The coping is activated through psychosocial support. Now, coming back to our Chauhan. So although he had a spinal metastasis, his pain was not neuropathic. So we could wean off the neuropathic medications, put him on analgesics, and he was, you know, able to sleep, turn, sit in with, along with the spinal brace. And the fentanyl patch was used. The son's engagement became a priority in the family. And his pain goal also, because he was due for retirement, for a high-level central government official, retirement send-off is a big function and they look forward to it. And he wanted to attend it with dignity. So this bed sores had all come because he was bedridden because of the severe pain. And he could manage to handle that pain. The bed sores healed. And so we can say that we reduced the serious health-related suffering. He was comfortable enough, and yes, he attended his retirement ceremony and gave the most inspiring speech of his life. This was a suit that they had stitched for him much before he had even been diagnosed with his metastatic disease, and he could actually wear it. And you can see the spinal brace that is put. He's on a wheelchair. One of our nurses accompanied him. And I have this much to say for today's class, and I look forward to the questions. And I request all the faculty here to chip in if there are questions which I am not ready with answers. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for a wonderful presentation. So, ma'am, we have certain questions in chat. First is, can you please elaborate on conversion of peroral to subcutaneous and to IV in opioid naive and non-naive patients?
I could share a slide which gives the exact, because, you know, from parenteral, it is generally considered as twice more potent. So when we convert, it will be half. So depending on the drug, and from methadone to morphine, from fentanyl to morphine, it requires an elaborate discussion. But I could share, let me see if I can just share a slide with you. That would be simpler. So I'm going to share because that is so much easier to explain. Can you see the slide?
Yes, ma'am, we can.
Yeah, so this is something which can be used, and so you can see that, you know, conversion between oral morphine to different subcutaneous morphine or tramadol, tapentadol, buprenorphine, transdermal patch, codeine, methadone. Methadone is, of course, it's complicated, and transdermal fentanyl. The general, and you should remember that transdermal fentanyl is in micrograms and morphine is in milligrams. So this is only as a guide. We should be, again, individualizing the dose. It's not an absolute number. And there is incomplete cross-tolerance that we need to respect before converting the drug. I hope this answers the question. Is that okay, Anuja? Shall I stop sharing?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is the pain diary mandatory?
I mentioned that it is not mandatory because many patients cannot use it. But, you know, some... It not be in this form, but in today's era, when we are discussing virtual care, this becomes a very useful tool that I have noticed in our patients. But it can be used in simpler forms. We can just give a paper with, you know, the dates and the time, and ask them, like, you know, when did you give the medicines? And it is also, you know, we know the engagement. So we can do some phone follow-ups to ensure that they follow this. It's very useful for us. It is not mandatory.
Ma'am, there is one very important question is, if patient has seizures, is it okay to begin tramadol? And what would be the way forward to start tramadol?
Yeah, so tramadol is got a side effect of, you know, lowering the seizure threshold. So why would you use that? Why not use something else? It is not necessary. For example, I think I did not emphasize that. A step 2 medicine, morphine, for example, can be used as a step 2 medicine as well as a step 3 medication. So morphine in a lower dose, like for example, a 5 milligram dose, can also be used as a step 2 medication. So there are options. So I don't see why we should use something which is known to have a, you know, seizure side effect. If anybody else wants to contribute, one of the faculties, it would be better, because this is how I would have seen.
Nandini, can I just...
Please go ahead. Yes.
No, this is not about the tramadol. The previous one, converting from oral to intravenous morphine is 1/3. No? For subcut, we usually take half. So just to add that. The IV, I think, was not mentioned in that slide. So maybe you can...
Yeah, I only mentioned sub-Q. Yeah. So anyone to answer this tramadol question?
If patient has got history... I'm Sushma Nandini. If patient has history of seizure, I think we can avoid tramadol. There are many other drugs. I think we can avoid.
Yeah.
And we should know the cause of seizures, and then accordingly, we can decide. It will depend on it will be your decision, clinical decision, based on the history, based on the cause of seizures, and avoiding. We want to avoid further complication. I think we can avoid tramadol, absolutely.
Thanks. Anuja, next question.
I think there is a comment on that by Dr. Shrikant. He says that all opioids can lower seizure threshold. Tramadol more than morphine, more than fentanyl.
I have not... Yeah, I would like to see the evidence. It would be very interesting because I didn't know that.
So, Dr. Shrikant, if you can share the evidence for this. So, next question is a case, actually. It's a CA prostate patient with multiple bone mets with a VAS score of 8 on 10 and 30 milligram ER morphine twice a day and IR SOS 10 mg. So, if pain control is not satisfactory in such patients, can we add benzodiazepines for sleep if patient is not able to sleep?
I wouldn't go that way in my thinking, because until the pain is taken care, benzodiazepine will only cause confusion. So you're talking about incomplete pain relief or lack of sleep. If it is incomplete pain relief that is causing lack of sleep, we need to directly look into the pain. I think here the assessment of pain becomes high priority. And all the points that Dr. Rajgopal mentioned about, you know, prescription adherence, reassessing the pain, and making sure that the pain relief is achieved, I think would be the next step, and not giving benzodiazepine for sleep. If this is, no, that would not be the way I would go. I would, again, request other faculty to chip into this response, because these are all, you know, individually, each of us may handle it differently.
I think again, Nandini, you are correct that rather than starting benzodiazepine, we should again reassess. Whenever there is an inadequate pain relief, rather than increasing medication or adding medication, new medication, we should first assess our patient that whether I have missed something which is very important. Maybe because he is worried about something and he is unable to sleep, rather than worried about the treatment. So we should explain the patient, assess again, and then try and do the extra dosing or increase dosing.
Yeah, thank you.
There is one more question, ma'am. I think it is related to this question. That is, sometimes patient says that I'm more comfortable with morning evening tablet of morphine and have adequate pain control with that. So then, even if patient is comfortable, should we be prescribing 4-hourly morphine?
I think a patient who says that way is probably taking only morning and evening dose and he's comfortable, and we should go by it. I don't know, if the patient is comfortable, that is what we want to achieve, right? So if he's comfortable, we don't have to go by the theory book. We have to go by the patient's disease experience and the pain experience. So if they are comfortable with just BD dose, and your book says that you have to give it 4-hourly, and his kidney is normal, serum creatinine is normal, it should have been, you know, said no. If patient is comfortable, it is fine. I have a patient who is most of the time only like, you know, on bed, except for middle of the day when she actually walks out. And that is the time she gets pain. So she has her pain only when she's moving. So she requires pain relief only during that time. But she wants to do that because she wants to do little dusting and cleaning on the house, old lady. So we need to, again, that is why the pain goal is important. All these other things are for us to know pharmacology and the details so that we become flexible to the patient's need. I'm very thankful for that question because that is the most important part. It is not that we have to just, you know, reflect everything that we learn, but we have to engage with the patient's needs and tailor it. Thank you for that question.
Thank you, ma'am. I agree with that. And let's move forward to another important question that has been asked. What is the procedure for teleconsultation to prescribe opioids?
We are still in, Sushma, can you give an update of our, you know, we have presented a letter to the MCI board because currently as per the MCI board's mandates, teleconsultation was not adequate for prescribing or initiating opioids. So we had given a clarification and I think almost 1.5 months ago, IAPC has presented it. So if you could just update, it would be great.
So, when I first given this letter to the right person, he was completely in consensus that there should be a mechanism that at least for pain patients, they should be able to prescribe opioids. But as usual, he has made a committee. And in the committee, there are people, those who think that opioids are bad drugs still. So I'm just again and again, today, 9 o'clock is again in the evening. At night, I have an appointment with Professor Paul because his whole day is busy. He has told me to talk to me at 9 p.m. So today I will again talk to him because this committee should not hamper our aim to make our patients pain-free. Because he himself is very, very convinced that yes, we should be able to do it. Let's hope that we will be able to do it again. Because it's a bureaucracy, they have to make a committee and then committee, who will be the member of the committee, this or everything depends on the committee members. So rather than working with the committee members, I thought I will talk to him that can we do something for the committee and if somebody of us can go to the committee and can emphasize that these are important drugs for cancer pain patients at least. So let's hope, and Nandini, it is taking time, but I'm working on it.
Yeah, thanks. So now to clarify, there is a small loophole in that, in the sense that, you know, there is a group of, for initiating, they have put this barrier, but there is also another group of drugs which they have shown where they have said that you can continue the ongoing medications, where they have not clearly indicated what should not be and what should be. So I checked with oncologists because their drugs, the chemotherapy drugs also come under the same group where you cannot initiate it through teleconsultation. So I said, what do you do for your drugs? So they are saying they're using that particular thing, you know, that part, that are, you know, drug B, I think drug list B. So I checked with the, you know, even the, some of the lawyers and checked whether this reading would be okay. And I think we can continue an ongoing medication, but still the MCI board's teleconsultation rules do not allow us to initiate it. We may have to do face-to-face, yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Sushma ma'am, for this update. Another question is, when patient compliance with strong opioids is not good, how do we choose the appropriate way to prescribe?
So again, compliance is a story usually, and we need to sit and listen to the story as to what is causing the patient not to take. Are there, you know, it could be some fears in the head, it could be a constipation, it could be a nausea, vomiting, whatever it is, we need to understand. Or it is simply that, you know, they are not pill types. So depending on the type, the reason why a person is not compliant, we need to respond. Otherwise, by taste or anything, opioid is, you know, quite, it's not because of anything else. There is some reason behind it. So unless we understand the reason, we will not be able to solve the compliance. So if a person is, just not the pills type, we can calculate the transdermal dose or a sustained release tablet, or because it is difficult for hourly to keep on, you know, popping in tablets. Or it could be because the constipation is too much, or it could be the nausea, vomiting. Whatever it is, we need to address that and continue. Engaging with the patient is the answer to that question.
Ma'am, one more question, ma'am. Can I please ask, ma'am?
Please go ahead.
Ma'am, one patient is already on buprenorphine patch or fentanyl patch. For breakthrough pain, I tell them to use morphine instant release tablet. Patient tells that if she takes the tablet, she gets vomiting. I am comfortable with the tapentadol or ultrasound. Is it okay with stepping down with weak opioids for breakthrough pain?
If the patient is comfortable, I would say yes, of course. The patient is not comfortable with morphine breakthrough and the tapentadol is giving her breakthrough pain relief, why not? I don't see any reason not to. Yes. Along with, although the WHO ladder says we should not be combining the two, but that isn't the like we should not be prescribing regular morphine and regular tapentadol or tramadol. But this is not that. The continuous pain relief is by a patch, and this is only for breakthrough pain relief, and I think it's completely okay. I would say yes. Yes. Yes.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Moving on to next question is, when do we call a pain as opioid resistant pain? Is there any maximum dosing before we term it opioid resistant?
So there is no ceiling dose to morphine, at least. We can keep increasing. I know of patients who have taken 600 milligrams per dose. And, so it completely is very individual. So there is no ceiling dose. But opioid resistant pains could be because they are not predominant nociceptive, or it could be a mixed pain. It could be. So we may have to, again, the answer to that question is reassess the pain. And there are very clearly, pains which will not respond to opioids, which is like muscle cramp, skeletal muscle cramp, or a smooth muscle colic. All these are not going to respond to opioid. They are clearly opioid resistant pain. Whatever dose that you give, you'll only worsen it, and skeletal muscle cramp will not respond to it. So otherwise, if there is a nociceptive component and the patient has partial pain relief, then that is also support for us to understand that, yes, this is responding to pain and it's just a matter of optimizing the dose. So if the patient does not respond at all, then we have to reevaluate. But if the patient has partially responded and it's just a matter of understanding the right dose, because I have seen in some centers, they reach 20 and 30 milligrams and they feel, oh, now it is too high, I don't want to increase. That is not true. We can increase if the adverse effects are within control and if the patient is doing well and the pain is, sequentially getting relief, we can still step up each time 25 to 50 per 50% of the previous dose. I really recommend you to go to Pallium India website. In this presentation, I have a link attached in that Robert Whitecross's, that EMA slide. So that is actually about, created by Dr. Robert Whitecross, answering the frequently asked questions related to morphine, oral morphine use. And they are beautiful. They respond to every common question that may come to our mind. Why 4-hour leave? What is the rule about driving? And there are many other things which are, beautifully addressed. And I really request you to go to that site as a resource and read up about the different questions and answers.
So, Anuja, I think rest of the questions we can send to Dr. Nandini.
Yes.
And Dr.
Yes.
Send it to people, because now we are over time already. Okay. Huh? But Nandini, it was such a wonderful presentation. Mm-hmm. I think